Good afternoon, muy buenas tardes. Hope you're all doing well wherever you are. Les mandamos muchos saludos. I'm Yarel Ramos, anchor of Edición Digital California on Univision, and I'm just really happy to be here and joining all of you. This is Habla USA and the Univision Creator Network presenting Real Talk, Latinx, Race, and Solidarity, discussion, a conversation to provide context for everything we've been living, what we are living in this country, the importance of racial justice in the United States, and of course, that intersection of Latinidad and the Black experience. We want to make sure that we as a community understand the oppression of Black lives and do the work to become anti-racist, because acknowledging that racial inequalities are our issues by dismantling racism is our fight, and our fight as well as a community. You see, I always saw myself as a woman of color. I still do. My parents are from Mexico, immigrant parents, first generation, Mexican indigenous roots. But if you see me, I'm a white passing Latina, and that is privilege, a privilege that I was given by an oppressive system, set up by an oppressive system. And what does that mean? What do we as a community, what do we do with with these formations, with these biases, with these understandings? How do we change? How do we make an impact change, and how do we do better? That's the discussion today. We are so thrilled to have you and very happy to have our panelists, because we have an amazing group of Latinx leaders joining us today. And we're going to start off by presenting them. We have first off Gadiel Del Orbe. You've seen him on social media. He's an actor. He's a producer. He's a writer, a comedian as well, and he's in Los Angeles. So thank you so much, Gadiel, for joining us.
All right, gracias por tenerme. I'm excited to be here, and I'm glad that we're having this conversation.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Next up, we have J.P. Dominguez. He's the creative director of Hazlo Media.
Everyone, so excited to be here with great panelists. Such an important conversation to have right now, and let's get to it.
Awesome. And I'm sure you've seen them on social media. They do amazing work with women, for women. Brujas of Brooklyn, las doctoras Griselda Rodriguez-Solomon y la doctora Miguelina Rodriguez. Thank you, ladies, so much for creating space also for all of us to do the healing work in this conversation.
You're very welcome, Yarel. Thank you for hosting this. Thank you, Univision Se Habla USA, for hosting this very vital healing, also difficult conversation. We're ready.
Absolutely. And last but not least, we have Led Black. He's the editor-in-chief of Uptown Collective. Y está conectado con nosotros from New York. So, Led, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, and I'm happy to be part of this conversation that we need to have right now. We need to move forward. The old narratives ain't working. Let's create new ones.
That's the spirit. And we encourage all of you, if you're watching on YouTube, to send us your questions, concerns, ideas that you have, so we can as well pass them on to our panelists. And the first question, of course, has to be what we've been living these last few weeks as a country, demanding racial equality and racial justice for all of our communities. I would love to start off with you, Gadiel, and for you to share with us your experience as an Afro-Latino, your experience mm-hmm. with Black Lives Matter.
You know, I grew up in a household that was told that Black is not beautiful. That was told que uno tiene que arreglar la raza. Sea lo que sea, aunque uno yo sea Latino, yo soy negro como quiera. Y cuando un policía me ve a mí, me va a tratar igual como lo trata el resto de los negros. A mí me ha parado. I've been stopped and frisked just because I was walking too fast. And what I want to start doing is I want to start showing this conversation, by at least because all this Black Lives Matter movement right now we're talking about is Univision, you're having this interview with us, and we appreciate this interview with us. But I also think that we should have had this conversation 20, 30 years ago. So that's my two cents on everything.
Great. JP, what about you?
So I've had the ability to cover the protests and some situations that affected the Black community during the last election. And then I also interviewed some people on my podcast a couple years ago. But I have to be real and transparent. In high school, they don't teach you the reality of the situation. They give you a cookie cutter version of what happened, you know, hundreds of years ago. And they don't tell you what's currently happening. college is where I was really able to see racial gerrymandering, injustice happening all over, voter suppression. What's crazy is this still going on, right? Just last night in Kentucky, you know, in two heavily populated minority group districts, they had one polling place. They should have had way more. And it's unfortunate that we're still here, that people are still trying to do the same tricks that they did beforehand. And I really attribute my legal education to really getting into what really is the problem, is that our Supreme Court justices are trying to rule on law that is based on culture that was systematically racist from the beginning. Slavery was accepted back then. Our founders accepted those things. So, you know, there's so much that we need to change. I'm sure these great panelists are going to expand on that more, but definitely there's a way to limit and suppress our voices. And they're trying to do that even subtly right now, acting like we don't notice.
Right. Mm-hmm. Thank you, JP. Miguelina, Griselda, you do a lot of work with women uplifting their voices. And I personally love to see everything that you do. You share also a lot about your experience going back to the Dominican Republic, having these conversations about race and even anti-Blackness in your own homes. Can you please elaborate on that?
Yeah, so unfortunately, just like Gadiel, we were raised in a Black Dominican home, aesthetically and culturally, but we were raised in an anti-Black home where Blackness, especially U.S. Blackness, was deemed to be inappropriate and unacceptable. So, you know, we take a stance as Black Dominican women in embracing our Blackness, and we find ourselves very committed to Black Lives Matter because we have experiences with racism and being racialized. We are light-skinned Black women, so like you, Yarel, there's certain privileges that we have because we don't have Blackness embodied in a very obvious way. So we definitely wanna make sure that we center this conversation around the reality that if you look at the panelists, we have each and all been racialized in one way or the other, but the face of racism among Latinos is not necessarily represented. But you know, we're getting there. But I think that this conversation is very important because Latino is not a race. Latino is a multiracial ethnic label. So you have Black Latinos, like some of us on this panel and hundreds of thousands of others who are racialized and have a very Black experience. And we are very much about Black Lives Matter. I think that what's important about Latinx folks, Latinos, having this conversation is that we are censoring Blackness in a diasporic way, where we're understanding that there's a specific Blackness that was rooted in the US, which is an African-American experience. And there's also global Blackness, diasporic Blackness among specifically Latin American and Caribbean folks that's very similar to US Blackness and also different, but nevertheless, like Adiel's experience, and I'm sure Led's experience, especially with Black men, they're still racialized. You know, it don't matter if you take out a Dominican passport, like, you're still racialized as a Black man. So I think that it's very important that we're having this conversation to really recognize that there are Black Latinos that are for Black Lives Matter, that have a very particular Black experience in the U.S.
Right. Miguelina, anything you'd like to add?
No, I think Griselda captured it. We're Black. Black Lives Matter. Our lives matter. And we're very big on not dichotomizing the two, where certain signs, when I see like Latinx for Black Lives Matter, I don't shun it because it's very important and there are non-Black Latinos and Latinas. But in terms of the Brujas of Brooklyn, Griselda and Miguelina, we are Black Latinas, so we are part of the movement. And I love something that Led said when we were preparing for this meeting last week. We're in the trenches. We're in the trenches of this movement. He and I were just at a protest last weekend together, and I saw he and his wife because we're in the trenches because this is our movement as well.
Right. And I think this is, I mean, just listening to all of you and your experiences and what you've encountered, I think the reason why we wanted to include also different voices is to make sure that we can pass it on and become that megaphone of the voices that we haven't heard, the voices that we need to hear from, to understand that whatever our platforms may be, we continue on elevating these voices and these causes. Whether you are, you know, a white passing Latina, a light-skinned Black Latina, to make sure that these conversations continue, because like Gadiel said, we haven't had them. We haven't had them enough in our endeavors, in our platforms. Led, you also have a very interesting experience. Tell us about growing up in New York, your experience with your mother, also in the Dominican Republic.
Yeah, like first of all, you know, kind of piggyback on what the Brujas said, and I love the Brujas, I love everyone on this panel. So Dominican Republic, right?
We love you too.
The island of Quisqueya, right, is the cradle of blackness in the Americas, right? So, you know, when we talk about 1619, which is a really important number for my black brothers, American brothers and sisters here, right? But the first African slaves to land on this hemisphere was on my island, on Quisqueya, in 1502, 100 plus years before. So the primacy of Dominicans as blacks is super important, right? So when my mother came here, right, she fed me to DR like at 3 months old. So when I lived in DR, I lived in Villa Juana, which is the inner city of DR, super black, right? So like I've always been in the trenches with everybody else. So there might be someone darker, the hair might be kinkier, but we here in the trenches, right? So I think it's like, I don't like to separate. We're just a different kind of black, but we still black, right? And it's like the diasporic aspect is super important, right? Because that's the connection. And if it's something that we need to, I think that what makes Dominicans important is that we are Afro-Latino. We're both black and Latinx. So we're that bridge to bring the community together. Because the only thing that we're gonna win, the only way we're gonna win is through unity, right? Like we gotta be straight up about it. Like if we allow ourselves to be divided, we're gonna lose. In New York City, the people that died from COVID was black and brown, right? Mm-hmm. So that's real, because we're in the front line, we're the ones dying. So if we let that unity, if we allow others to divide us, we're gonna lose, and we can't lose. This is our world.
Right. Mm-hmm. I love how you talked about something that is on for the next question about unity and about understanding, because I think as even for myself as a journalist, being, you know, on the social and the digital space, it was I was being very, very hard on myself, trying to dissect my identity based on my experiences, based on the fact of growing up in a poor community, growing up in a very humble environment, realizing that the dualities also of the places where I was from, and then coming to a conversation like this and asking myself, Who am I to talk about this, right? Why can't I talk about this? Where do I go and learn? Where do I learn and how do I listen? Because I can never understand the experience that you, Led, have had. I can never say like, yeah, I know what you're talking about, because I can't. Or you, or Miguelina, or Griselda, or Gadiel, as I'm assuming, you know, JP can attest to it. It's a completely different experience.
Right.
So I know that even for a lot of us in the space of acknowledging and understanding, it's become also a very kind of like an intersection of like, what do we do, right? How can we elevate these voices? How do we become that megaphone? How do we become an ally? So I would love for you to elaborate on that. On being of solidarity, but also being of understanding and of believing what is going on in the Black community within the Latinx bridge. So I don't know if Gadiel wants to take it first.
Yeah, I see it like this. You know, as a white Latino, you got to ask questions, educate yourself. There are books on Afro-Latinidad. Learn about our history. Our history is not learned. Our history is not learned. We mostly teach the European history, how Christopher Columbus came over, you know, and all that stuff. But we don't know anything about ourselves. You know, there's like an erasure of our history. But even though there's Afro-Latino museums in New York and Harlem by Arturo Schomburg. So also being an ally is not only what you do in front of us, what you do when we're not around. You know, are you having these conversations? Cuando alguien dice, tú tienes pelo malo, are you correcting that person? That's what you do as an ally. What do you do when we're not around?
Okay. JP?
Yeah, over the years, I've had the opportunity to do behind the scenes work on many social justice issues. One of the things that I always try to point out is you are not the voice for those who are oppressed. You are not the voice for those who are going through the injustice. You are there to help contribute. You're not there to be a savior. You are not there to be someone who calls the shots. You are there to fill the role that they need to help amplify their microphone. They have their own stories and they have their own points to make. And, you know, sometimes we forget that. I know many people watching this may feel like they're being yelled at. It's because why do we have to wait so long to see violent acts on the television for us to actually do something? activists are exhausted. They don't want to answer your questions. We should be taking things in our own hands and researching and trying our best to, you know, help amplify the causes and what they're trying to do.
Brujas, I know you have, like I mentioned, just a lot of work with the social and the digital community. What are your conversations like? What do you tell white Latinos about their experiences, about these conversations they need to be having with their family members, with their communities, how they can be allies and join the cause in solidarity? How do we do that?
I think I go back to my teaching experience. Griselda and I are professors within the social sciences in the City University of New York system, CUNY. And I think of my students and what do I tell my students? And a text that I teach every semester is Pedagogy of the Oppressed by Paulo Freire. And he's very big on something that JP just mentioned. The oppressed are the ones that need to lead this emancipation. The oppressed are the ones that need to lead this liberation. And we allies need to know their positions. I look at it like a huge highway where there's different lanes. We need to all stay in our lanes and stay focused and understand who is in the front, who's in the middle, and who's in the back. And I think that allyship is where you're there. We are working together. You're there to uplift us, but you're not there to do the work per se, because that's for us to do. We're the ones that will set the rules, set the tone, and set the pace of this. I think we need allies. We absolutely do. I just watched the Malcolm X, Spike Lee joint over the weekend. I hadn't watched it in years, and I sat and watched it. And a very important scene is when Malcolm X is still in his very militant stage, and he's leaving a talk, and a young white lady goes up to him, and she's like, "I'm an ally. I want to know what I can do." And he says nothing. Right. But then later on, he goes to Mecca and he transforms himself. And like, it's interesting how a lot of people like to cherry pick Malcolm X and look at like Malcolm X in his militant stage. And that's fine because we do need that. But we need like El Malik Shabazz also. We need that acceptance. We need that love. We need that allyship. But again, it needs to be like, it's not an All Lives Matter party. That's not what this is. It's still Black Lives Matter, but it's about allyship. Like, know your position, understand that you do your work. As Gadiel said, read the books, go to the museums, and then come through. I love it that when you go to protests here in New York, the organizers are like, our white allies, stay in the front, in the periphery, and in the back. Do not come in the middle. This is not your march. And if the police come, you will serve as kind of like a buffer. It's sad, but it's real and it's true. And I love it that in the march, it was like surrounded by our white allies. And it was beautiful to see because we do need each other. We just need to know our positions.
And I think the question is rather complex because of the earlier point about Latinos being a multiracial ethnic group, because there are still a lot of Black Latinos that don't identify as Black, right? So that's very important to also remember that there's also resistance coming from within the community of people that are not just allies, but are central to the movement, but have been conditioned, as Gabriel mentioned, via miseducation to identify more with the colonizer than with their true essence. You know, and then there's also grades to this. We exist in intersections of identity. This is not a Black or white thing. Existence is not Black or white. It's because it's like we're Black, we're Latina, and then we're women, but then we're cisgendered heterosexual women. So we lie at an intersection that gives us heteronormative privilege, right? And that's something we have to also acknowledge, that we were not the voice of trans folks, and we can amplify those voices, but we act as allies within the LGBTQ community. And that's something that I'm very self-reflected on. Like Yarel, you're a white Latina, but you're gendered as a woman and you exist in that intersection where you may have white privilege, but you are gendered and treated in a way because you're a woman, right? And I think that we have to start sophisticating these analyses and complicating them, because they're not that simple. And something also that I'm always very, very aware of is that, to keep it real, there's also resistance coming from within some folks in the Black Lives Matter movement when Black Latinos step up and they're like, yo, we Black, we here, we've been here, and we're ready. And they kind of look at us sideways with suspicion. And when I say they, I mean some folks that are in and of themselves still indoctrinated in a colonial mentality that looks at Blackness in a very narrow way, either just specifically about skin tone, which that's understood because that's how a racialized system does work, on racializing people in a spectrum, colorism. The darker you are, the less likely you are to be considered human and viable and have access to resources. But at the same time, we also have to open up the discussion about that, that, you know, I'll speak for us Dominicans, is that Dominicans have a history of denying their blackness, and it's unfortunate, but we also have a rich history of embracing our blackness, right? So mm-hmm. I'm here to represent the truckload of black Latinx folks, of black Afro-diasporic folks that may look like us or darker or lighter, and are like, we black, we're here, and we're ready to do the work, you know? So it's very interesting how, for me, black Latinx folks, we exist in like this like really interesting crossroads.
Yeah.
It's like, and those that are darker have experienced this in a particular way based on their own anecdotes. Like they're too black to be Latinx, and they're too Latinx to be black, right? So these conversations are important because like Dominicans say, estamos complicando el cuadro. Like it's not simple about like, are you an ally or not? Because based on different spaces, Miguelina and I may show up to a BLM rally or something, and they're looking at us like, yeah, allies. And we're like, no, right? But I think to add real quick, this is, our work is very central on healing as Brujas of Brooklyn, mm-hmm. as women dabbling in spirit, because this movement, this new paradigm that we're ushering in, everybody needs to be as grounded as possible, because you will then be swayed not to be an ally, not right. to be part of the movement. Because if you identify as anything, and you know you identify because you read and you unlearned all the garbage that you were indoctrinated with, and your experience, nobody could tell you what you are and what you aren't. And you're like, Lex said, we're not fighting, instead we're not fighting each other, we're just becoming unified. So the work is about educating ourselves, but also doing the spiritual work, the healing, the therapy, those conversations.
Yeah, absolutely. I back with everything again, with healing in the space that I think that's what we also wanted to bridge with this, the space of where we can comfortably talk about all these nuances and everything that we're living and everything that we're experiencing and even what we don't understand, but also understand that there's a lot of work within us to be done to be better for the community, and even to be, if that's what you want to be, an ally for what we're living right now. Led, would you like to add anything on that? Because
yeah.
when we had this conversation, you brought that up, and I love if you can share.
When we were speaking, you actually said, which is interesting, that it's not enough to not be racist, right? You have to be actively anti-racist, mm-hmm. right? So we're not in those white spaces, right? So if you're saying those damn Dominicans or those damn, we're not hearing that, right? If you're there, you have to confront it, right? You can't let that slide. But I also feel that, you know, you have to meet people where they're at. Not everyone is where you're at, right? We all had our awakenings, right? So
yeah.
so I can't beat you over the head because you're not there yet. And I also think it's important to stress the interconnectedness of it all, right? That what's done to me today will be done to you tomorrow if you let it happen, right? So, for example, when we were having the Black Lives Matter protests in Buffalo, the police threw a 75-year-old white man on the floor, right? Think about that. Like, so white people ain't safe either, and there's a class component here, right? So if black, brown, and progressive whites if we get together, we could change this world overnight, right? So look at this. 58 in New York State was repealed a week ago, 3 weeks after Floyd died, right? That law had been in the books for over 40 years.
Mm-hmm.
But when we came together, we changed the world overnight, right? And we can do that. And that's the point, that we can make a better world is possible if we come together. Right. So to our white people, our white allies, say, yo, just come on the front lines with us. When you're there with your people and they say some wild shit, you correct them. Say, nah, that's not cool. We can't move forward that way. We really want to make a better country. Let's do that heavy lifting that it entails, and let's do it together.
And that's such an important subject, because we've seen it all even throughout these last few weeks. Like even when we hear it within our own safe spaces, you know, within our own family members, within our own friends. They changed you if you don't say anything about something that you don't like or something that you're okay with. Like you've allowed them to change the way you perceive what's going on. So, you know, as I know that for a lot of us, even living and you know, doing a lot of work on social and digital, it's been having those conversations, as uncomfortable as they are, with our parents and our tios and our cousins who say things that sometimes are not okay, or friends who believe things that are not true. So thank you, Aled, for touching on that.
May I say one more thing?
Mm-hmm.
Because I have a story that I always tell, right? And it was, I was like 14 years old. I had just read Malcolm X, you know, I was like, I'm black, we're black, you know, it was just really about that. And fight night was a big night in my house in Washington Heights. All my dad's friends would come over, right? So there was a dude, and he's Dominican, 6'4", like big dude. He looks like the New York Giants linebackers when the New York Giants were important, right? And this dude is super dark. He's so dark that his nickname is Rubio, right? So his nickname is Blondie, right? So we're watching the fight, and there's a black American fight on the screen, and the dude that I know, Rubio, keeps going, mira ese prieto, right? So he goes, look at the black guy, look at the black guy. And I said to him, hermano, usted es prieto. And he goes to me, yo no soy prieto, yo soy blanco oscuro. So he said he's dark-skinned white. Mm. It doesn't exist, right? So, but it's something that it's not just anti-blackness. He's anti-himself in a lot of ways. Right? Mm-hmm. In front, right? That there's nothing wrong with here. There's nothing wrong with dark skin. Those things are beautiful, and we all got to learn that, right? No one comes into like this world tells you the opposite. So it's like you have to fight to really like instill beauty. I have three daughters. They know they're black. They know they're African. They know they're Dominican, and they rep, you know, and that's important. Mm-hmm.
Thank you for sharing that, Led. You know, we talk about the social media posts. We talk about where does it, you know, beyond the protesting, what do we all have to do to join in the fight to amplify these voices? Gadiel, you were in the military. Your experience was also very much shaped by those years, those formative years in the military. With all that knowledge and now what you do as a producer and as a comedian, as an actor, and what you've seen on social and digital, what do we do as a community to support and to continue to have the movement progress with everything that we're seeing and living right now?
Yeah, what I would like to say is, since I'm a producer at BuzzFeed, I have a platform. And my job is to not only educate, but also awaken, you know, a lot of people in Latin America, because a lot of black folks think they white. You know, so that we've been oppressed so badly that we started to hate ourselves, right? So I think, first of all, continue creating the content. I'm an influencer. I'm going to continue making work. I would love to, in the future, to make movies. I would love to make TV shows that represent our people, our culture. And also with you guys. You guys have a massive platform. I appreciate you guys bringing us over. But, you know, also creating shows, creating content that represent the rest of us as well, will normalize that we also exist as well.
Yes, very true. JP?
Education, definitely education. I'm a firm proponent of educational resources online, but that's obviously not enough. One thing that I did find a couple weeks ago that I thought was awesome was Project Implicit by Harvard. New eyes and ears are watching this. If you haven't done it, series of questions. They go over sexual discrimination, racial discrimination, huge eye opener, because it shows you your inherent bias of some things that you may not be aware of. Def recommend that. And then I was watching the Facebook Live of that the Brujas of Brooklyn participated in last night. And I thought what they said was really, really important. We can all contribute in different ways, but not everyone has to have the same role. So some people can be the people that are driving to the protest. That's exactly a recommendation they gave. And then also, you could also help digitally by, you know, starting petitions, right? You could get online, help amplify those. There's so many different ways you can do it. But like we said earlier, it's just about making sure that the people that have the mic are those that are experiencing injustice and the oppression. And then one last note, Yarel, you noted this. We are called, for the people that are not black, we are called in this time, in this moment. We were called way before, but, you know, right now, to when those comments are made at the dinner table, to not just brush it off like that's my crazy tío, my crazy abuela, like we are called to step up to the mat and make sure that we make it known that that's no longer acceptable, or else we're going to be here in a couple years from now. We can be the change right now, or we can continue to ignore it.
Right. And, you know, something that I find really important, I think that I've been very adamant within in my line of work, in my space, within my newscast and around my colleagues, is that we cannot just have one presentation like this and say we're done with it, right? Oh yeah, we crossed off, we check mark it. We have one Afro-Latina representation and we do our, that's our token for this community. That you talked about this a few weeks ago when you talked to Ilya Calderon on the network. And I was very moved by the fact that you felt that a part of your interview was was cut off.
Yeah.
Because you were holding us as a company and as a platform accountable for the narrative and also for the context of what was going on. So please, I give you the floor to
Thank you.
Dale.
And I've been meaning to post the whole interview and I forgot, but they asked what a similar question like this. Like,
sorry, Mr. Softy, the ice cream truck is passing.
What can we do? And I started it by saying, well, this conversation at the time, the one I was having in Aquí Ahora, was it. Sorry, that's Brooklyn in the background.
That's when you know you're in the hood.
Yep, love it. So, and I said, well, having conversations like this, because Univision, like Telemundo, at least in a New York City context, have been known to propagate anti-Black ideologies across their programming. The fact that Hilda Calderon is the first Black anchor in a Latin American Spanish language news program in the United States is preposterous, but I'm very proud of her. I'm very proud of us. You know, but I think that is deeper than Univision, you know.
Absolutely.
Because I think that these ideologies stem very, very old. They're colonial, about the villains in the novelas, and the temptresses are always the darker ones, with the nappier, curlier hair, and the savior
is like indigenous.
You know, if it's a Mexican context, it's like La India Maria. We grew up with those movies. So I think that, yeah, I think that and we will keep holding these networks accountable and also acknowledging, right? Because I think that answering the question, what can we do to support racial equity? I think that one of, and I really hope that he's tuning in. I'm going to have a little stand moment, an academic stand moment. One of my favorite authors is Eduardo Bonilla Silva. He is a Afro-Puerto Rican Black Boricua who now heads the sociology department at Duke. And I love his work. His work, like Silvio Torres Sayan's work, like Gloria Zantua's work, like so many others, have really changed my life. And the one thing that he taught me, and the many things that I've read of his, is we need to radicalize spaces. Radicalize every space you're in. What does that mean? If there's something off about something being said, it doesn't matter if it's about race, gender, sexuality, whatever, that you use your voice, no matter what, to correct the person. If there's a space that you're walking into that's low and people are demoralized, you be that compass, you be that light and lift the spirits. Because I think that we've all touched on self-hate being very pivotal to why Latin American folks, Latinx folks, somos complejao. It's on purpose, it's by design. And when you get at a person's psychology and sense of self, you demoralize them. So Brujas of Brooklyn, we're committed to raising the vibrations and radicalizing spaces wherever we go. And Miguelina, please, what's her name? Speak even when your voice shakes.
Michelle, we'll get her name.
Because people attribute it to Audre Lorde, but yes, speak, because everybody in this room, you know, all six of us have had experiences where someone in your family, someone in a boardroom, one of your friends during a bar night said something and your heart is right here. Gong, 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 gong.
And then you don't say something and 4 days later you're in the shower like rehearsing what you should have said.
Yeah.
You have to move beyond that. And I think it's having those tough conversations. I hosted a Zoom this morning, a Kundalini yoga Zoom, and the conversation was about cancel culture and how toxic that is. But to the center of that, we don't mess with toxic culture, but we're very big on, like, if you had a conversation once, twice, three times with the same person, then maybe that person in this lifetime is not meant to get the message, or they're not meant to get the message from you, right? Racial equity, for me, the work has to start within. It has to start by unlearning the stuff that we were indoctrinated with, learning the reality, the truth of your history. And then the main word that came to mind when I first read that question is, you must be unapologetic.
Yes.
You must be unapologetic. Unapologetically yourself. Does it mean you have to be confrontational? Do you have to be mean? No, you just have to be unapologetic, and you have to be like you have to be really grounded. And I'm sorry, I forget who was it that said it earlier. If you're not, the littlest thing can come and it can sway you. It can sway you and it can have you like, maybe I'm not as radical, or maybe I shouldn't go down this rabbit hole, right? So the last thing I want to add about this important question is, visually, I am a visual person. Seeing myself represented is important, but Yarel, as you said, not tokenism. seeing myself represented in positions of power. I would love to see Univision and scroll through your Instagram and see all hues, see all textures, see people even dressed differently, because it seems a little bit like a monolith right now. And as Latinos and Latinas, we are definitely not a monolith. So right. That's one way to bring racial equity, a visual change that's not like coded in tokenism.
Right. Thank you for sharing that, Brujas. And I know Led and I, we spoke about this, and we talked about racial justice, racial equity in terms of this new generation that's holding all of us accountable for doing the work and that won't let these things go by. Can you elaborate on that?
Yeah, I think this younger generation is not having it, right? When they see something that they don't agree with, they're not playing. And it's really because of them that things are changing, because you see them say, nah, we're not having it. So it's this kind of, they're not accepting of the nonsense anymore. And then sometimes, you know, you come to this country, our parents come to this country, and they're here to work. They don't want, they want to keep quiet. They want to stay under the radar. But these kids are not having it. And I think what we have to stress is that there's a connection between George Floyd dying like an animal in the street in Minneapolis and kids in cages like animals on the border, right? And that we stress that importance, because as long as we stress that importance, we can get through to our people. And also, one thing that I want to say is that there's a plan afoot to divide Black and Brown, right? That's why you have someone like Candace Owens always trying to separate Black and Brown. Oh, the immigrants want to take your job. The immigrants want, that's a tactic. That's a ploy. You know, and I think we need to be wise. And I want to say also, I agree with John Leguizamo, right? Latinos for Republicans is like roaches for rape. So we need to get real and get rid of Trump. Trump is public enemy number one. And I have to say that.
Thank you for sharing that, Led. It's something
that was beautiful.
You said, I thought about something, a quote I saw the other day, and it was, the same racism that deports us is the same racism that killed George Floyd. So when we talk about being about it and like talking about these inequalities and racism in general, we're all under the same umbrella.
That's right.
You know? And the fight is not just for, you know, my father tells me this all the time, and I'm sure you've heard it, like when the fight is for our Muslim brothers and sisters, and then you don't stand up, and the fight is for the LGBT plus community, and you don't stand up. When it gets to you, there's going to be nobody left, because you right. never stood up for the rest of the communities that were in need. So thank you guys so much for everything you've been sharing with us. I know we've been getting a lot of questions on YouTube, and I would like to take it there. The first one from Claudia Martinez, and she asks, how do we talk to our parents about racism?
I don't know. I'm still talking to my parents about it. Es una conversación que nunca termina.
Yeah.
Sea lo que sea, when they say something, especially in front of people, you gotta call them out. Just like the Bruja said, you gotta speak your voice, even though your voice shakes.
Yeah. And love. I think that. Yes. And it doesn't mean love. Doesn't mean like, okay, I'm mommy. Because my mother is down the hall, and when she comes out her face, I'd be like, Ma, tú no te atreves. Tú no te atreves. You know, like sometimes you gotta be your parent's parent, right? We know that.
And it's role change.
You know, but I've learned with a lot of love, because our parents are traumatized. Seriously, when I started to really shift my perspective and see my family as traumatized from being indoctrinated and enslaved as African and indigenous people, and then migrating to the US and being exploited for cheap labor, and then being discriminated against because of their skin color or their accent. Our families are heavily traumatized, and we have to come at them with a lot of tenderness. Like Niga says, but if you tell somebody, like I have, you know, my husband's African American, and my family has been fixated on his hair, and they knew before he was born, like, él no tiene pelo malo, but if I'm telling you 5 times que no le diga pelo malo, yo te voy a dar un boche, like Dominicans say, I'm gonna have to like really call you out. But I think we have to lead with love, because our folks, we're all traumatized in one way or another, but the vehicles, you know, they're strong, and they put a strong face, but like, we're dealing with some heavy post-traumatic stress disorder, truly.
And I think, you know, we're almost in our 40s, and we've been doing this work for a long time. And
it's taken years for us to soften up and to understand that
we, because this is not us in the in our 20s, absolutely not.
We've had to learn to soften up, and you attract more bees with honey. It's so cliche, but it's true. And JP, you said you tuned in to the live we had yesterday where we all grow. And one of the things I said is we were talking about Afro-Indigenous spirituality amongst the Latinx community, and we use that as a way to reclaim parts of us that were stolen and were hidden. And I had to learn that I can't sit and embrace like La 21 Divisiones, the 21 divisions, an Afro-Indigenous religion and way of life in the Dominican Republic, and then shit on my mom's Catholicism. And say, I can't believe you're white saints. Oh my God. I had to just be like, that's where mommy is. That's where mommy is. That's not where I am. And I'm going to show her that black is beautiful. And the thing, like us getting pissed up, and my mother's like, oh, yes, at home. Oh my God, are you going out with your hair like that? Through years saying, don't tell me that. Don't speak to me in that way. Y ahora, now she doesn't say it because we had to like humanize it and say, like, it hurts my feelings.
Yeah.
And you have to say it again and again. But Gadiel was right. This is a conversation that does not end, and it is not for the faint of heart, but it's good.
And that question was asked three times by different viewers. So we know it's a question that they want to know. And, you know, everyone, people that are watching want to get recommendations. And by the way, un abrazo a su mami, because I saw that video after she saw you on TV, and it was adorable to see her and see how proud she is of you. I think we're all proud of las dos doctoras que tenemos aquí con nosotros. So thank you again, you know, for the work that you're doing. Next question. Another question from Claudia Martinez. Is there more than one way to lead social change? And I know, JP, you talked a lot about this in terms of the work that you've been doing in kind of like your political and your legal career. If you can give us some help with that question.
Yeah, no, definitely. It's aligning yourself. You got to speak your truth, right? So whatever that truth is, it comes down to how you're raised. Let's say you have a new truth, right? That you've been enlightened. You've realized that the way in which you thought of certain political issues in the past is wrong. You have the ability to take actionable steps that go farther than just being knowledgeable, right? So we can all research, we can all find information, but if we don't take those actionable steps, literally we are not doing anything to contribute to change. And that's the ultimate goal. So as far as my legal career and political career, I just like to amplify those people that are doing amazing things. Like for example, the other day, there was an awesome headline, Yarel, I know you posted about it as well, was how someone told a young Mexican girl while she was going to high school that Mexican girls don't go to Harvard. Not only do we know that they do because she ended up graduating with a doctorate, but that's just one story that is just going to continue to happen, because you know what? These may be dark times. These may be times where like everyone's trying to hit us in the face in all different ways, but let us use that as a motivating factor that no matter what, they're not going to consume my energy. We're going to come back and we're going to show them with actual actions that prove them all wrong.
Right. And that's very interesting that you mentioned, because that young lady that went to Harvard, and when she told me that that when she was young, they told her that she's undocumented. So even the idea of higher education was beyond her. It was another Mexican girl who told her that. So within her own community, they were the ones that were like, Mexican girls, Latina girls, we don't go to Harvard. And her breaking down those ideas and these boxes, you know, that society and all these sectors of life have set up for us. You know, I would love to end it with a question about the future and a question about the promise of the future for our communities. I know we all have, and we all come from different avenues of life. But what does the future look like for in 10 to 12 years? And if you could create it in the midst of everything that we're living, what would it look like, Gadiel?
For me, if I could create the future, I would say black lives, black people will live just as white people has always lived.
Yeah, period.
JP?
Yeah, I'll never forget a political discussion I was having in college. My white roommate was about to take a shower. It was a heated debate about immigration reform. And he put the towel over his shoulder. I'll never forget it. I remember it clear as day. And he goes, you know, it doesn't matter what you think. Rich white people are always going to decide the future of this country. So this is all irrelevant. And like, I'll never forget that because of this. We are here to make the change and amplify in our own ways. We all have different experiences, different realities, but we can all contribute. And if we want that future to change, it goes deeper than just having political discussions. It has to do with creating that different future for our kids, right? Because this is our generation. Led talked about Gen Z, like, not taking anything for granted right now. And they just, like, hit you. When something's wrong, they'll let you know. But, like, why can't we create a different reality where, you know, all the mistakes that our country is rooted in, we accept as realities, as facts, that we don't get offended. Why get offended over dark realities that are true? That we move forward and we say we are going to be the change, but we're also going to make sure that we make actionable changes, not only in legislation, but in our local communities. Right. That's the hope.
Right. And also, you know, something to mention is that the Latinx community is poised to become the most influential voting bloc. We talk about this every year, but this is an election year. And everything that we've been going through in terms of kids in cages, Black Lives Matter, COVID-19, everything that we've been living, how do we show up for each other in terms of everything that we're going to be voting for in the next coming months? So that's something to keep in mind. Anything that you, Griselda, Miguelina, what about you? The future for you?
I think the future for me is laced with love. And again, not the kumbaya, we're all going to sit by a campfire and pretend that things are okay. A reality that's laced with revolutionary love, real love. What JP said, have really difficult conversations about the realities of what happened in the past without shunning it or without getting offended. Being able to talk about a very painful past in a way that's healing and in a way that's uplifting. And honestly, just love. I would love for us to live in that gray area. As social scientists, I draw a circle the first day of class on the board, and I say, a lot of us, we live on this circle. We live on that margin for different reasons. And I would love for all of us to come back into that gray area and understand that two opposing poles can exist in the same space at the same time. But that requires a level of emotional intelligence that we're not there yet as a collective, but we are getting there. We're like, we are there on our way.
I'm a mother of a beautiful 5-year-old Black boy, and I'm very excited for the future. The future is now. That was the past, and now this is the present. The future is now, like, literally. And I'm led to share my absolute favorite author and theorist in the world is Audre Lorde. And like Miguelina teaches the pedagogy of the oppressed in every class, I teach one of Audre Lorde's pivotal pieces, which is the uses of the erotic. And she really breaks down this idea of eroticism not being like fornication or pornography, but truly, and pro-ho, I'm sorry, that is her handle. I forgot her name, sis, but she says something that stood with me. It's like an orgasmic yes. Living our life where everything that we do brings us extreme joy, like truly, and that requires a dismantling of systems that don't allow for us to feel that level of joy because of lack of access to resources. And things like mass incarceration and deportation and, you know, the discrimination of people based on gender and sexuality and race. But truly, a future for me is a future where every single body could take deep, belly fulfilling breaths and know that everything that they do is laced with a level of joy that's enough to fulfill their life. And that currency for us is going to be beyond money, that our current currency is going to be based on how much joy something brings me.
That's beautiful. Thank you. Led, you have the last word on this.
Thank you. So for me, the future looks like freedom, justice, and equality, right? I think one of the things the pandemic has revealed is how unfair this whole thing is, right? And that the status quo is not going to work, right? It's either this country's for everybody or for nobody, right? So with that understanding, like, we have to make our numbers work. The great Jay-Z, one of my favorite MCs, said, men lie, women lie, numbers don't. Let's take these numbers that let's make these numbers mean something, right? Let's go out and vote. Let's change this world. Let's change this planet, because we can. And it's better for someone to be born and have the same rights as everybody else, the same opportunity, the same ability to aspire and we can do that. Like, right, what we got to realize is the time is now. We can't wait till tomorrow. That we cannot wait. Oh, it's gonna come down the line. Right now, we get together and we change the world. And that's the only, either that or it's just a doomsday. So let's avoid the doomsday and let's get together and change the world.
I love it. Thank you. And I just wanted to clarify that some of the audience questions, I said Claudia, but Claudia is actually on our team, came from Pierce Orellana and Diana on YouTube. And another question that we had, the last one that I think would be great to end up and our discussion today, is also from Diana 512-09. And she wants to know, what are some books you recommend for her? What are some resources she can read or watch or see where she can learn and amplify also her knowledge?
I mean, two books for me that come to mind that are like just beginners is Harvest of Empire by Gonzalez. It just starts from what Les said earlier, when like the slave ships reach the shores of the Western Hemisphere. And then it goes into different histories, specifically Spanish colonialism, when the Spanish came and colonized what's today Latin America. And Open Veins of Latin America by Eduardo Galeano. And it talks about the interference of U.S. relations in Latin American countries and how it leads to the poverty and corruption that causes so many of us and our families to migrate. So Harvest of Empire and the Open Veins of Latin America. My recommendations.
One book I would recommend, The Afro-Latino Reader. The Afro-Latino Reader by, I think is Jimenez, and I'm blanking on the other editor, but it is a edited volume of over 20 chapters covering the entire Western Hemisphere, specifically looking at the reality that people of African descent exist all over Latin America. Mm-hmm. And each chapter is dedicated to like Mexico, Cuba, Dominican Republic, Puerto Rico, Colombia, Peru, Argentina, like really acknowledging that we're here and we've been here and we will be here. The Afro-Latino Reader.
Any other recommendations?
Yeah, I want to say that I got two recommendations. So the autobiography of Malcolm X, that was my gateway into blackness, right? I didn't know I was black until I read that book, and it broke open my head reading about Malcolm's story. And Malcolm was a really intelligent black boy whose teachers hated him. And I had that same experience in the New York City, you know, school system, right? You know, New York City school system is as segregated as Mississippi. Yeah. Right. So when I was a kid coming up in 143 in Washington Heights, I was smart and my teachers hated me. Right. And then I didn't understand. And when I read Malcolm X, it really revealed a lot to me, and it changed my whole life. It took me from being an angry kid to someone with purpose and direction. And it made me devote my life to learning. And the second book is The Warmth of Other Suns by Isabel Wilkerson. It's about the great migration of black folks out of the South to the northern cities, and how that changed everything. It led to the civil rights movement, because that book is so beautiful, because you really understand what black people were going through in the South. Like, if you think about black people in the South, they couldn't walk on the same sidewalk as a white person. You know, you think about that kind of vile discrimination, lynching, you know, those things were so vile that we need to know that history to understand that we can't let that, you know, like last week, oh, the June 9th, there was a noose found in Fort Tryon Park, which is right down the way. And not a noose, there was a black man found hung from a tree in Fort Tryon, and the police labeled it a suicide, right? So we can't pretend that this is not in our front door, right? Like, this is real. So that's what I think those books make you understand how real this is. And I think we need to get real with it.
I'm going to get real nerdy. Go read Supreme Court decisions. Like, there's going to be a lot of words that you don't understand. Trust me, not even lawyers understand them. But like, if you read Brown versus Board of Education, you see where some of these justices, their opinions are rooted on so much misinformation. And then also you kind of understand scope of, okay, the Supreme Court's role is never to make the law, it's to interpret the law. So how are they interpreting this? And are they interpreting it in a way that's going to benefit our communities? And like, so sorry to get nerdy, but.
No, it's great.
Yeah, those are my recs.
Great recommendation for sure. Gadiel?
I have a couple. I have three of them. Afro-Latina, but it's with the Arroba Reader by Flores Jimenez Roman. Afro-Latin American by Andrews. Neither Enemies Nor Friends, Latinos, Blacks, and Afro-Latinos. These books will also talk about, like, you know, how America has impacted Afro-Latinidad in Latin American countries. And I think that's a good way to deep dive within our Afro-Latino history.
Perfect. We're going to put all of these recommendations together, and I'm sure the Sabla USA team, the Creator Network, will be sharing them on all our social platforms so that everyone that's watching and been trying to catch up with their recommendations can also check them out. I cannot thank you enough. I know we took some time out of your schedules. We've been going back and forth with this to make it happen, but we really wanted to make sure that we created this space where we can all have a conversation that is much needed through generations, through communities that are watching. And we hope that, you know, you enjoyed it. We hope that you also were able to gain something from it and that you join us in the future. Yeah. We're huge fans of everything you do, Gadiel, JP, Brujas. led, and we're just very grateful for the time and the energy that you spend here. We want to thank you, our audience, you. Also watching at home. Thank you for taking the time to also learn and unlearn a lot of these things that we've been instilled with through generations, through society. We hope that you take on everything that you heard today and continue the work. Like we mentioned, we are the we're poised to be the largest voting bloc. So make sure that your vote counts. You prioritize legislations that benefit Black communities, that benefit Latinx communities, for the well-being of all of us. That we learn, that we educate ourselves, and that we also untie all those knots that we've been carrying for many years, for many generations. Thanks to the entire team for making this possible. Thank you to Sabla USA, the Univision Creator Network, for putting this together, for creating, again, the space and the time. And we remind you that we'll be having another panel July 16th, another panel of Real Talk, because, again, I think that holding us accountable as well to the work that we're doing, we need to continue on to have these sometimes uncomfortable conversations with our audience and with everybody that's interested in what's going on, to be able to shape what's happening with our communities. So once again, thank you so much. I'm Yarel Ramos. A huge hug to our panelists. Les mando un abrazo. Cuídense mucho, and we'll be in touch soon. Buenas tardes.
Gracias. We'll be right back.